I want to thank Mehmet, who Bolgun, who's my favorite atomist and a good friend in Turkey, for inviting me to participate in the first English version of this series. It's my honor to be part of this. I know both participants, so I'm glad to be part of, and I respect them both highly, so I'm glad to be part of this discussion along with them. Our respondent today will be Dr. Mohammad Bazil Altay. He's a recently retired professor of quantum cosmology at Yarmouk University in Jordan. He's now living in England, and after the pandemic, he'll take up a post in the science and religion program at the University of Edinburgh. He obtained his PhD from Manchester University, and he's published widely on the topic of quantum cosmology. For those of us interested in science and religion, his two best-known books are God, Nature, and the Cause, Essays on Islam and Science, and The Divine Word and the Grand Design, Interpreting the Quran in the Light of Modern Science. And I recommend both of his books to you. Our presenter, who will go first, is Dr. Enes Doko, my best Muslim friend in the world. He's professor of philosophy at Ibn Haldun University in Istanbul. He earned his doctorate in 2016 in theoretical physics at Koç University, and he's published in both science and philosophy journals. His most recent books include Introduction to Analytical Metaphysics and Axiological Arguments in Defense of a Contemporary Moral Argument. I'm going to turn this over to Enes, and then he'll deliver the main talk for the day.
Okay.
Then we'll take a break and come back and hear Bazil's response. Enes?
Thank you. So let me open the presentation. So let me look at the time to make sure that I don't speak too much. So my basic topic, which will be, I will be talking about, is multiverse and theism. Basically, I will try to assess what kind of relation there can be between the multiverse hypothesis and theism. So basically, by theism, I mean that there is omnipotent, omniscient, and perfect intentional agent, God. So it's something which all the monotheistic religions believe in. So basically, by theism, I will mean Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, their conception of God. So let me briefly discuss the multiverse. So in the Middle Ages, this was the universe people believed in, we are living. Basically, we were thinking that Earth is at the center of the universe, and we are living in a finite universe, which ends up with the sphere of stars, which is basically what we know today as the solar system. So we thought just the totality of everything is the solar system. But then this picture changed. And when we came to the 20th century, we realized that sun is just a star, and stars are as big as the sun. They are billions of stars, so we live in a much bigger universe. Of course, even that time, we actually discovered our position, the position of sun in the Milky Way galaxy in 1918. We discovered that just sun is an ordinary star in the Milky Way. Still, there was a debate whether Milky Way is the totality of the universe or it is just part of the universe. And basically, this big debate ended in 1923 when Hubble discovered that Andromeda is a separate galaxy, and the conception of galaxies came out. So we realized that Milky Way is just, again, a single galaxy among billions of galaxies. Of course, today, nowadays, we debate, the question is whether this picture, which we call universe, is the totality of everything, or whether there is something more. So what could be the next step in this search? Well, this is where the multiverse comes into the play. So what is multiverse? Basically, it is the claim that there are more than one universes. And what I will mean by universe is basically a region of space-time which is causally disconnected, or basically better definition would be a region of space-time which is causally closed. Basically, everything which interacts with each other is inside this region of space-time. So basically, these universes are causally disconnected from each other. A better definition would be, of course, at one time, because it is possible that these universes will interact with each other in the future or in the past. But there is a time at which these universes are causally disconnected from each other. Space-time regions which are causally disconnected from each other. And there are three types of multiverses. Basically, there is the so-called spatial multiverse, temporal multiverse, and metaphysical multiverse. So let's define them one by one. So usually when we think about the multiverses, the idea which comes to our mind is the spatial multiverse. In this, actually, we have a huge meta-universe, which is subdivided into small regions of space-time. Basically, we have one huge universe, and this universe is divided into small regions, smaller domains, which we call universes. Our universe is part of these domains. Each domain may have a different physical laws. It may have a different constants of nature. It may have different initial conditions. So depending on the type of the multiverse, these universes may be completely different than each other. The examples of this would be a level one multiverse, which is the simplest form of multiverse. Basically, in this model, laws of nature are same, constants of nature are same, but just the initial conditions are different in these separate universes. That's the most basic form of multiverse. And actually, most of the physicists today believe that this multiverse really exists. So basically, there is a cosmic horizon beyond which we cannot see and interact now. Many physicists believe that this is not the end of the universe. So there is more stars, galaxies beyond this cosmic horizon. And that's where a different universe from our perspective starts, because we cannot interact with this region. Another very popular model will be Andre Linde's chaotic inflation hypothesis, in which this is the picture of it. Basically, we have a universe which is separating. You can think like a bacteria or cell which is constantly separating. And basically, in each of them, depending on the version, you may have, again, different laws or different initial conditions. Another example would be quantum mechanical multiverse, in which different outcomes of a measurement results in a division of the universe. So basically, but still laws of nature are same, just different outcomes happen in different universes. So these are examples of special kind of multiverse. So as you can see, there's not just one type of multiverse, but there are more than one kind of multiverse. And as I said, many cosmologists today do believe in at least level one multiverse. Here is a quote from George Ellis, who is actually one of the greatest critics, like the most famous critics of the multiverse. But he does acknowledge that level one is widely accepted. So here is his quote. Astronomers are able to see out to a distance of about 42 billion light years. Our cosmic visual horizon, so that's the point at which for this we can see. We have no reason to suspect the universe stops there. Beyond it could be many, even infinitely many domains, much like the one we see. Each has different initial distribution of matter, but same laws of physics operate in all. Nearly all cosmologists today, including me, accept this type of multiverse, which Max Tegmark calls level one. Of course, this may sound like very not important result. You may say, well, if they are just, we have a bigger universe, if the laws of nature are same, it's not interesting. Well, if the universe is infinite or very big, actually, given the finite nature, given the atomic quantized nature of our universe, the universes will start to repeat themselves. So it turns out that if the multiverse is really big, even in this version, there are strange things, like there will be a copies of me eventually, because universes will start to repeat themselves. A second kind of multiverse is a temporal multiverse. Many people actually are not aware that this is a form of multiverse. In temporal multiverse, usually we have a single universe which exists, then disappears, and a new universe emerges out of the old universe. So basically, this is kind of oscillating kind of a universe in which single universe expands, collapses, and new universe comes out. And again, there are some models in contemporary cosmology, although none of them is really widely accepted, which put this forward as a possibility. And this is what we mean by temporal multiverse, universes existing in different times. And the third kind of multiverse, this is what we really see in usually in the fiction, but also in philosophy. This is the metaphysical multiverse in which we have universes which are completely separated with each other. They are spatio-temporally separated. So they are not, there is not no physical mechanism which creates these universes. Rather, their existence is taken as a brute fact. And we have at least two versions of this. One such a multiverse is David Lewis's model realism, which tries to explain modality. Another one is Max Tegmark's fourth level of multiverse, which basically sees our universe as an abstract object, mathematical object, and he thinks that every mathematical possibilities exist. So basically, he tries to explain why our universe follows mathematical patterns. And these are like more philosophical kind of multiverse models. So we have many different kinds of multiverse. So what is the relation of multiverse with religion? So what would, why would a religious person or column scholar or philosopher of religion be interested in multiverse? Well, the recent discussion has to do with the so-called fine-tuning argument. So basically, mostly the discussion goes around this argument. And fine-tuning argument, many people think that it is one of the best arguments in support for the existence of God. And usually the objection to fine-tuning argument comes from the multiverse. So basically, some people see the multiverse as a kind of alternative to God and theism and explanation of the fine-tuning argument. So I don't know whether I want to spend some time explaining the fine-tuning, but basically this is the idea. So let me just show this, So let's just take a single diagram. You can see that in this diagram, actually we have a strong nuclear force and fine structure constant, it measures the force of electromagnetic forces, so the strength of the electromagnetic force. As a physicist, you can think, what are the possibilities? Like, what happens if I increase the interaction between the electromagnetically charged particles, or if I increase the electromagnetic force, or if I increase the strong nuclear force, which holds together the protons at the center of the atom. So you may ask, what will happen? How will it affect the life? So if you ask this question, you will find out that life is possible only in small region in the parameter space. Like if you take this picture here, our universe or the conditions in our universe are denoted by this blue sign, this blue dot. And you can see that this blue dot is inside this small white region, which is basically very small compared to the infinite possibilities here. And it turns out that life is only possible in this small white square rectangle. So inside this white rectangle, the values allow emergence of the life. Any other place, we don't have chemistry, we don't have life. So only life is possible in this small region. And it turns out that the conditions in our universe are inside this small region. And this is just one example. There are thousands such examples. Here you can see that electron mass and proton mass similarly is finely tuned. Just it allows life in a very small window, this small window. And again, our universe is in that window. So fine-tuning is the claim that the subset of conditions which allow emergence of life is smaller compared to the whole possible conditions. And this is actually a scientific claim. This is not a theological claim, because this is something you can calculate and discuss. But then comes the explanation. What is the explanation of our universe being in this small region? Why we are so lucky to always emerge in a region which allows life? Why all the parameters turn out to be in these small regions, like in these two examples? One answer is, of course, that actually God fine-tuned, arranged these conditions so that life emerged. So one way is to use this as a support for the existence of God. Another alternative would be to say that each point in these diagrams actually correspond to one universe. Basically, all the conditions are realized in one universe. Essentially, since if each condition is realized, it is not surprised that we also exist because our conditions should be also realized. So some people think that multiverse can indeed explain this fine-tuning without invoking God. And this is how the idea that there is some kind of tension between multiverse and God emerges. Here is a quote from Weinberg. If you discovered the really impressive fine-tuning, I think you would really be left with only two explanations: a benevolent designer or a multiverse. Of course, one can believe in both of them. This does not really mean that they are opposed, but this creates some kind of tension. And many theologians, including some in Turkey, I know, they oppose multiverse idea because they want to defend the fine-tuning and because they somehow see multiverse similar to evolution. So many people are against evolution, and many people therefore put some kind of they don't feel much sympathy towards multiverse. So here is a quote from Cardinal Archbishop of Vienne. So he compares multiverse to neo-Darwinism, and he says we need to fight with it. Similarly, like we fight with the Darwinism, we need to fight with the multiverse. Unfortunately, this is the idea of some people, also some Muslims. They see multiverse as similar to evolution and opposite. By the way, I think also evolution is not against theism, or it is compatible with Islam, but they put it into a similar line of thinking. So this was the introduction part about what the multiverse is and what is the tension. My personal opinion is opposite to this tension. I think actually that multiverse is not only compatible with theism, but under certain assumptions, theism implies multiverse, but more importantly, multiverse gives us a tool to actually answer some of the objections for theism. So I think many people, they see multiverse as destroying the fine-tuning argument, but I think multiverse can be used by theists to attack certain atheistic arguments. So that would be the second, the last part in my talk. So first, I want to motivate the claim that multiverse is not only compatible, but also under certain assumptions, which may be questioned, but under certain assumptions, theism, the belief in God, may lead us to believe in multiverse. So of course, I think it is quite clear that multiverse is compatible with God, existence of God, because there's no reason to assume that God may not create more than one universe. And I think if we look at Quran, the first surah, actually God himself calls himself the Lord of the worlds. He's Rabbul Alamin, which means if we interpret this as a world, as a universe, God is the Lord of the universe. So there's no reason initially to assume that God did not create a universe. Again, some people have interpreted the Quranic verses which talk about seven earth and seven heavens. If we think like earth and a heaven as the universe, some people have interpreted this as seven is also like referring to plurality. So there are like more than one universe. So actually there has been some, especially modern exegesis, which point that Quran is not only compatible, but about talks about existence of different universes. Of course, I'm not a tafsir scholar, so I'm not in a position to assess these claims. Rather, I will move into my area, which is philosophy, and I will try to give some arguments that given theism we have good reasons to believe that God may have created more than one universe. So here is a quote from Fahrettin El-Razi. He actually considers the possibility of existence of the multiverse. So here is the quote. It is established by evidence that there exists beyond the world a void without a terminal limit. And it is established as well by evidence that God Most High has power over all contingent beings. Therefore, He, the Most High, has the power to create 1,000,000 worlds beyond this world, such each one of the worlds be bigger and more massive than this world, as well as having the like of what this world has of the throne, the chair, the heavens, the earth, and the sun and the moon. The arguments of the philosophers for establishing that the world is one are weak, flimsy arguments founded upon feeble premises. So from the Kalam point of view, actually Aristotle gave an argument that the universe is unique, and some Muslim philosophers accepted his argument. They tried to defend. Kalam scholars were skeptical of this argument. So basically already in our Kalam school, we consider the possibility of existence of more than one universe. One interesting thinker who actually defended the multiverse in Islamic thinking would be Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah actually thinks that God is continually creating universes. So he actually defends a kind of temporal multiverse. So we already have in our tradition the defenders of some kind of multiverse. And actually the arguments which I will present are, some of them are very similar to the Ibn Taymiyyah's arguments he presents in defense of multiverse. So depending on the time, so I'm looking at the watch, I don't want to take much time, I will present the arguments. So basically I will present 6 arguments. I may just skip some of them, but I will present a few arguments in support of the view that God probably created more than one universe. So let's start with the first argument. So this is the argument from the creator attribute of God. So from Islamic point of view, God is the creator and sustainer of everything. Basically, we attribute the Halik, the creator attribute, to God. And of course, it is debated, but we may, if we assume that it is an essential attribute of God, then it must be always part of the God to be a creator. And even Quran talks about God being the continuous creator. He constantly creates. So this may lead us to develop this kind of argument. So here is the argument. God is the everlastingly the supreme creator. So God was always the supreme creator. God was always the creator. In order to possess creator attribute, one must have created something. So in order you to be a creator, you must create something. God created our universe. In other words, our universe has finite past. For God was supreme creator before he created our universe. This, of course, follows from the first and the third premise. Thus, God must have created some other universe before he created our universe. So if God was creator and he must create something to be a creator, he must create another universe before he created our universe. If God created different universe than our universe, then there is at least 2 universes, which means multiverse is true. Therefore, Islamic theism or theism implies a multiverse. So, of course, this argument can be criticized from many ways. So let me put a few possible criticisms. One objection would be to claim that God may have created non-spatial objects. That is, he may have created an abstract objects before he created our universe. Well, this is possibility, but it actually assumes that nominalism is false and that actually abstract objects are entities which can be created by God. And these are both are controversial claims. And even if we assume that God really created the abstract objects, God must be creating the abstract objects from the infinity. Otherwise, once he created the first abstract object, we can ask what God created before it. If God is continuous creator, he must have created something before this first abstract object, which would be again a universe. A second objection would be to say that in order to bear the supreme creator attribute, God need not have to create anything. One may say that the fact that he is able to create whatever he wants is actually enough to justify his attribute of supreme creator. I think this objection is not good because it confuses the omnipotence attribute with supreme creator attribute. It basically says that any being which is omnipotent must be supreme creator, but I don't think that this is really true. So they are not necessarily connected. We can easily imagine an omnipotent being which never creates, and we wouldn't be able to call that being a supreme creator. Another possible objection is to say that the universe is eternal and God is supreme creator because he sustains it or recreates it every second. So there is an infinite universe which is eternal and God is constantly creating that universe. This would be like some idea which some philosophers in Islamic thought thought about how God is supreme creator. Well, I think this has, there are two ways you can counter this objection. First, it seems to be in conflict with the belief that only eternal being is God. So in theism, we believe that God is the only eternal being. Second, if we take the recreation model, then one can say that this is actually a kind of temporal multiverse because there's a universe, it disappears and God recreates it. Basically, we can see these as two different universes in this definition. If there is no causal connection between these two universes, like the Asharites think, then one can maybe even say that these are two different universes, actually. This kind of temporal multiverse. Another objection, which is, I think, the strongest objection, is to claim that this argument assumes that God is everlasting. In other words, that God it assumes that God is temporal being. While we in Islamic theism believe that God is timeless, well, I think this is a strong objection, and it's true that most of the theologians and philosophers, actually including me, believe that God is eternal rather than everlasting. So he is timeless, but this argument still would be interesting for some thinkers, especially Ibn Taymiyyah, who actually thinks that God is in time. Like Salafi thinkers, they may be attracted to this argument because they believe that God is in time. So this was the second.
Just a second, Anas. Somebody said they don't have sound. Sumeya, I can see your face. Can you put your hand up if you can hear? Sumeya Kapusus, yeah, okay, so she can hear. So it might just be one person's problem. Okay, so go ahead, Anas.
Okay.
Sorry.
So it's good. I wasn't talking just to myself. you know, in one universe, this is happening, by the way. I am talking to just myself. So the second argument is the argument from moral perfection of God. So according to theism, and again, Islam, although again some theological schools will not accept this, but God is all good. And therefore, we may expect that God will try to increase the goodness and aesthetics of reality. He will try to create the best possible reality. And this idea has been defended by many thinkers, like Avicenna or Ghazali, Scotus, Leibniz. Many thinkers have defended that God probably created the best possible world. But of course, one may ask whether the best possible reality is really a universe. Perhaps the best possible reality is a multiverse. And recently some Christian thinkers, like at least let's say Western thinkers, have defended that if there is the best possible world, actually it is a multiverse. And this is an interesting idea, which again can be developed into full argument in support of the idea that God probably created more than one universe. So here is the argument. Let us define the universe worth creating as the universe which involves significantly more goodness than evil. So there is a universe in which the goodness or good suppresses the evil by certain amount. What is this amount? I don't know, but let's define universe Lord creating this, whatever this is. And let's look at the argument. So God is all good. All good being will try to increase the goodness and aesthetics of reality. All good being will try to create a reality which involves more goodness and aesthetics. A universe worth creating will increase the goodness of reality. So universe which is worth creating, which has significantly more goodness than evil, this universe will increase the goodness of reality because in totality we have more goodness. Therefore, God will create any universe worth creating. There is more than one possible universe worth creating. Again, there is no reason to assume that this definition, universe which involves significantly more good than evil, is actually a single universe. Presence of one universe worth creating will not reduce the goodness of another universe worth creating. So they don't subtract each other. If I create one, the other universe will not lose its goodness. They are independent. Therefore, God will create all the universes worth creating. Therefore, God will create a multiverse. So again, let's look at the possible objections to this argument. By the way, this argument is interesting and more interesting from the previous argument because it leads to theistic model realism. Basically, it leads to the idea that God will create all the universes which are worth creating. So God will create many, 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 many universes. Of course, God may use different criteria besides goodness. He may use justice, aesthetics. But still, it would be very strange if these criteria just add up to single universe, our universe. In fact, we seem to be able to think more better universe. Many people think that it's possible to think better universe than our universe. So let's look at the objections. So one can deny the claim that objective values can be attached to reality, basically because there are no objective values. One can say there are no objective values, hence this argument fails because it assumes that there are objective values. But I think this is not a really attractive objection for theists because we hold that at least God is objectively all good. So definitely you can attach some objective moral values to the reality. You can say that objective values cannot be attached to the universes, just they can be attached to beings like God. But I think this objection is really bad again, because if the values cannot be attached to the universes, first, there is no moral criteria which God decided to create our universe. So basically, he just randomly or for some mysterious reason, without any good reason, he created our universe. There was no criteria, objective criteria he used to create our universe. Secondly, this means that if there's no objective criteria which can be attached to the universes, this means that we cannot really say that paradise or heaven is better than hell objectively. But again, it seems that paradise and heaven, we are committed to this view that these are objectively better, the heaven is objectively better than hell. So hence, I don't think that again this objection is really good. One can say that the main criteria used by God when creating reality is not maximizing goodness, basically. Some other criteria, which of course may be true, but then again, I think these new criteria can be used to create a new argument. I don't think that it would be strange that the only universe which meets this criteria maximally is our single universe, and any other universe will destroy this. I think this would be very strange. So I think even if this objection is true, still any criteria we seem to be able to choose will lead to more than one universe. Of course, one can say, and some people do say it in Islamic tradition, that God does not use any criteria in creating the reality. I think this is a very bad approach. I don't like it because it seems to imply that God created the world arbitrarily, like randomly. There is no reason why he preferred this universe. And I think this is very strange again. So let's look at one other argument. So that is the argument from No Best World. Suppose you are not attracted by the previous argument because you believe that there is no perfect reality at all. There is no perfect world. And certainly there are such a thinkers like Alvin Plantinga, Richard Swinburne, who have argued that there is no best possible world. But if this is true, William Rowe thinks that this is a problem for perfect being theology. This means that perfect being is not possible. While William Rowe uses this as an argument from perfect being theology, I think this argument can be used as an argument for multiverse. So here is how this argument can be put forward for the multiverse. So for any given universe, there is a better possible universe. So this seems to be the point of Plantinga and the thinkers who think that there's no best possible world, because for any given universe, you can find better one. With the dancing girls, you know, classic example, you can add more dancing girls, more beauty in this universes, and you will make better universe. If God created a single universe, then his work is morally suppressible. So God created a single universe, there is a better universe, and he created this one, which means that it was possible for God to create a better universe. He didn't do the best job he can do. Third premise, God is the greatest possible being. So this is the perfect being theology. If God is the greatest possible being, then his work is not morally suppressible. Then God's work is not morally suppressible. Therefore, God did not create a single universe. And therefore, God created a multiverse. So let me give an argument. This is, okay, let me pass this argument is because it's more, I don't want to spend much time. I will give one more argument and then go to my last point. So another form of an argument we can put forward is again from perfect being theology. Basically, we can argue that God is the best possible creator. We cannot think any better creator than God. And it seems certainly that if we have a God which created more than one universe, which created all the possible worth creating, the universes which are all worth creating, and we have a God who created just a single universe, any of them. It seems intuitively that this God which created the multiverse is better creator, higher creator than the God who created just single universe. But if we say that the God is best possible creator, as we believe, then it means that God created all the universes which are worth creating, which means God created the multiverse. So anyway, we can advance another arguments, like using perfect being theology, you can say that God will be the highest loving being and he will increase the number of beings he loves. You can give this kind of argument. If you believe in omnisubjectivity, that God shares our memories, our internal states, conscious states, then if he's the best possible being with omnisubjectivity, then again he will create infinite beings which he will share their subjectivity. Anyway, so these are all speculative arguments. So I'm not claiming that they demonstrate that the multiverse is true, and that if you believe in God, you must believe in multiverse. I don't make this kind of claim, but what actually I claim is that under certain assumptions, it is not unreasonable to believe that multiverse exists. It is unreasonable to say that it is reasonable to believe under certain assumptions that God created more than one universe. Therefore, what I call the multiverse theism, the idea that both multiverse and theism is true, is not an unlikely position. It is not something which is very irrational to believe. But what is the main implication of this, especially the theistic model realism? I think it counters many evidential arguments for atheism. So what are the evidential arguments for atheism? So there are two kinds of arguments for atheism we can put forward. Some of them are logical arguments, basically, which tries to demonstrate that either God is incoherent, so God's some two or three attributes or God or single attribute maybe is incoherent, or some phenomenon we observe in nature is incoherent with the God, existence of God. So these are logical arguments, I would say, for atheism. The evidential arguments are arguments which are, while compatible, we have a phenomenon in universe, while it is compatible with theism, it is very unlikely that God will lead, will create that phenomenon. The most famous example of this is, of course, the evidential problem of evil. The claim that given the evil we observe in the universe, in the world, it's very unlikely that it is created by omnipotent, omniscient, and a perfectly good being. So this is the evidential argument for evidential problem of evil for atheism. I think most of the evidential arguments for atheism, they share the following form. So this is a generic argument which actually involves all these different evidential arguments. So here is the argument. The actual universe, the universe we live in, has a future X with degree Y. So we have a certain future in our universe with some degree Y. Evil would be an example. Actual universe has a evil in it with certain degree Y. So it's like very, this, like we give a measure to the evil. Or actual universe has hiddenness of God. So God is hidden in the universe with degree Y. So it can be religious pluralism, a phenomenon which has certain degree and which seems to be in contradiction with the theist. So actual universe has future X with degree Y. So there is a possible universe, some other universe with the same future, but with a degree which is less than Y. So in other words, you can imagine a universe which has less evil than our universe. You can imagine a universe in which God is more known. It's less hidden than he is in our universe. You can imagine a universe in which biological organisms are better than they are in our universe. You can imagine a universe in which there is not so much religions and we are not so much confused how to connect with God. And it seems that God would prefer this other universe to create to our universe. Number three, so this is that claim. Probably God of classical theism will prefer this PU, the possible universe, over the actual universe. Since he will try to minimize the degree of X. He will, because he's omnipotent, omniscient, omnibenevolent, he will try to minimize the evil, or he will try to make himself more known to the humans, or he will create us in a better biological shape. We will have less illnesses, we will be more happy beings, or he will create less religions, so we will be less confused how to reconnect with him. So this is the third premise. The fourth premise, which is, I think, the critical premise, actual universe exists and the possible universe does not exist. So while the actual universe exists, the possible universe doesn't exist. And if you believe in all these four premises, it follows that probably God does not exist. And usually theists will attack the third premise. They will try to show that that God will prefer our universe over this possible universe by arguing that there are some reasons. They will give some responses why God allowed this much of evil, or why God is hidden, why there is some imperfections in the biological organism, so on and so forth. But I think a better move is to reject the fourth premise. How do we know that PU does not exist? The real question is, if we say that PU exists, then this argument fails. Basically, the fourth premise is false. And if the multiverse theism is true, actually the fourth premise is false. God did create a universe in which there is no evil, if it is possible. God really did create a universe in which there is less evil, which I think is reasonable to assume. It would be very strange if this is the minimum amount, or universe we live with minimum amount. Intuitively, it seems very difficult position to defend to me. So if this other universe is a universe in which there is, say, just a single religion, or there are less religions, this seems also possible. And if goodness is more than evil, then God will create this universe. So it seems to me that multiverse theism, the idea that God created more than one multiverse, gives us a tool to counter certain evidential arguments for atheism. So that's why multiverse is, in my opinion, of course, I'm not talking about the cosmological multiverse, more it's this is more philosophical kind of multiverse, is more useful to theism than atheism. By the way, before I finish, I have like 3 minutes left. Most of the cosmological multiverse models are also not useful for rejecting the fine-tuning arguments, because almost all of them, with a few exceptions, they don't have a mechanism to change the constants of nature. So they don't have a mechanism to explain fine-tuning. For example, quantum mechanical multiverse, or say most of the cosmological multiverses, they all involve the same constants of nature. So they don't actually solve the problem. Only multiverse models which solve the problem are very, very, say, more speculative kind of multiverses, or again, you go in the boundary of the philosophical kind of multiverses. Anyway, thank you very much for listening. Hope to take both your feedbacks and Mr. Basel's feedbacks would be very useful. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Enes. Excellent presentation. We're going to stop here for 10 minutes. Why don't we start at the top of the hour? We'll take a break until the top of the hour, and then we'll come back. We'll start right away at the top of the hour with Basel's response to Enes. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you back after the break.